Hi students, this is Karim Nisa Sayed, Associate Professor in Zoology. Welcome back to session 49. In this session, we are going to learn histology of mammalian small intestine under the zoology paper 4. So when we learn the organization of different types of tissue layers present in the mammalian small intestine, definitely we are going to appreciate its adaptations to its functions. What is small intestine? Small intestine is an important organ in the digestive system of an animal, which lies between the stomach and the large intestine. Most of the digestion and absorption of the food occurs in the small intestine. Therefore, small intestine is about 20 to 23 feet long, and it folds many times to fit in the lower abdomen of the animal. Though it is longer than the large intestine, it is called small intestine because of its smaller width or the radius. Small intestine consists of three important parts, namely duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. Duodenum is the first and shortest part of the small intestine, which ranges from 20 to 25 centimeters in length, and it is having characteristic folded C-shaped structure. Duodenum receives gastric chyme, that is the food from the stomach, and the passage of food into the duodenum is regulated by a pyloric sphincter, which guards the pyloric orifice. Duodenum also receives digestive juices from the pancreas and also the liver. Duodenum, that is the wall of the duodenum, also contains a lot of mucus secreting glands called Brunner's glands, and the secretion of these glands is alkaline as it is having a lot of bicarbonates. So these secretions of the wall of the duodenum, along with the bicarbonate salts present in the bile secreted by the liver, help in the neutralization of the gastric chyme or the acid secreted by the stomach into the food. Therefore, the emulsification of fats occurs in the duodenum. As we all know, fats are not easily soluble in the water, but because of this alkaline environment of the duodenum, the fats, they turn into small vesicles called the micelles. The next part of the small intestine is called jejunum, which connects the duodenum to the ileum. It is about 2.5 meters long and contains a lot of luminal foldings called plicae, circularis, and also villi, that increase the surface area of absorption. That means jejunum is specialized for the purpose of absorption of the food, as it is also lined by the special cells, absorptive cells called enterocytes. So therefore, the products of digestion, like simple sugars, amino acids, fatty acids are absorbed into the bloodstream by the jejunum. And also the absorption of very small nutrients like vitamins and minerals, which are actually digested previously by the enzyme present in the stomach and duodenum region, are also get absorbed here in the jejunum. The next part of the small intestine is called ileum. It is the last part of the small intestine, which is about 3 meters long. And it is also having lot of luminal villi similar to that of jejunum. That means whatever food is left over or unabsorbed by the jejunum will get absorbed here in the ileum. So therefore, the main function of the ileum is to absorb the bile salts, vitamin B12, and also the remaining nutrients of the digestion. Ileum joins the cecum of the large intestine at the ileocecal junction, which is guarded by a wall. And as you see here, the jejunum, ileum are suspended in the lower abdominal cavity by means of a mesentery. And the mesentery is nothing but part of peritoneum through which the supply of blood vessels and nerves to the intestine also occurs. With that brief anatomical features, let us know the actual histological structure of the small intestine or the microanatomy of the mammalian intestine. Histologically, small intestine is similar to that of other organs of the digestive system. Therefore, small intestine also consists of 4 tissue layers. The first and foremost, or the innermost layer of the wall of the small intestine, is called mucosa, and mucosal layer in turn consists of mucosal epithelium, underneath which we have lamina propria followed by muscularis mucosa. Apart from mucosa, in the wall of the intestine we also see submucosa, which is a connective tissue layer which contains lot of blood vessels and also lymphatic vessels along with the nerve plexus called submucosal plexus. Below the submucosa we have muscularis externa, which in turn consists of 2 layers of smooth muscles, that is outer longitudinal and inner circular muscles. And in between these 2 layers of muscles, it also has myenteric plexus, which are nothing but the nerve plexus. And the last, or the outermost layer of the wall of the intestine, is called the serosa or adventitia. So the small intestine, as usually, is covered by epithelium, which is commonly called serosa also. So the intestinal mucosal epithelium shows lot of foldings called visceral foldings, on its luminal surface. So these foldings are similar to that of foldings of the stomach called rugae, but these foldings are called plicae circularis because these foldings are permanent foldings as they do not disappear with the intestinal distension or the expansion. In the jejunum region, these plicae circularis are well developed and they are called folds or valves of Kirkley or valvulae connivitis. They are less distinct in the duodenum and ileum regions. The mucosal epithelium, therefore, is lined by simple columnar epithelium, which projects serially, as you see here, along the length of the small intestine into hills and valley-like structures. These hills, they represent the villi, which are again permanent finger-like projections into the lumen of the intestine. These villi increase the surface area of intestine, which subsequently increases its absorptive capacity. These villi also become decreasingly prominent towards the distal end of the small intestine or towards the ileum. Centrally, as you see here, each villus has a core which is filled with connective tissue in which we see neurovascular structures like lacteals. These are nothing but the small lymph vessels, arteries, veins or the arterioles and venules, along with small nerve fibers. These villi, therefore, are filled with the lamina propria or the connective tissue layer, which also lodges a myriad of lymphocytes. That means large number of lymphocytes arranged in the form of follicles called Peyer's patches. These Peyer's patches, they aid in the protection of the body from the invading pathogens through the incoming food. So below this lamina propria, we also see a very thin layer of muscles, that is smooth muscles called muscularis mucosa. So this muscularis mucosa may also project into the villi to facilitate the motility or the motility of the food or the contraction and relaxation of the villi. This muscularis mucosa is also made up of outer layer of longitudinal muscles, as you see here, and also inner layer of circular smooth muscles. Between the villi of mucosal epithelium, we also see valley-like structure called crypts of Lieberkühn. So these crypts of Lieberkühn, they lodge the intestinal glands. So therefore, in the intestinal glands, we see various types of epithelial cells called Punnett cells, enteroendocrine cells, absorptive cells or brush border epithelial cells, mucus secreting goblet cells, and also few stem cells. The spaces are the crypts, as you see here. Therefore, they are continuous with the epithelial lining of the villi. Therefore, the crypts provide a communicative space between the epithelial cells and also the lamina propria with the intestinal lumen. The lymphatics are the lacteals, the cells, and the glands of the small intestine can be separated into two groups for our studies. Those that are found throughout the length of the small intestine and those which are restricted to one of the three areas, namely duodenum, jejunum, and ileum of the small intestine. First, let us learn the cells or the intestinal glands which are present throughout the small intestine. They include tall, columnar, absorptive cells that reside in the crypts of Lieberkühn, and they are equipped with lot of microvilli. So thereby they help in the absorption of the food. They are also called brush border cells. These cells are also secretory in function. The brush border cells also secrete brush border enzymes. The microvilli on the apical surface of the brush border cells also increase their surface area. So therefore, they facilitate the transport of small molecules into the enterocytes from the lumen of the intestine. That means they also increase the area of absorption. So just like villi, microvilli also increase the area of absorption. Next, we also come across unicellular epithelial cells called glandular epithelial cells, which secrete the mucus. They are also called goblet cells because of their shape. They are found, as you see here, dispersed between the absorptive cells of the mucosal epithelium. These goblet cells are the simple columnar epithelial cells which are having more height, the height which is about 4 times bigger than their width. They have a narrow base, therefore they are called the goblet cells. The cytoplasm and the nucleus of the goblet cells is pushed therefore towards their basal end. Therefore, at their apical end, they have large mucin or mucus filled granules. Therefore, the goblet cells, they can be seen as large, more pale cells in the cross section of the villi. Apart from these goblet cells, we also find some undifferentiated stem cells. These stem cells, they can replace any other type of cell if it becomes non-functional or if it dies. Apart from goblet cells and stem cells, we also come across Punnett cells. These Punnett cells or actually eosinophilic cells are, they secrete lysozymes or lytic enzymes into the crypts of Lieberkorn. Therefore, these secretions provide immunity to the intestine, as these lytic enzymes are antibacterial and the Punnett cells, therefore, they also exhibit phagocytic function. Apart from this, 3 to 4 type of cells, we also have hormone secreting cells called Argentiferous cells or enteroendocrine cells that regulate the secretions of pancreas, liver, and of course the gastric juices, along with the regulation of motility in the intestine. These hormones, which are secreted by the Argentiferine cells, include somatostatin, motilin, cholecystokinin, neurotensin, vasoactive intestinal peptide, and enteroglucagon. Moving little further and deeper into the structure of these Argentiferine cells, in the wall of small intestine of mammals, particularly we come across 4 main types of enteroendocrine cells. These are I cells, S cells, K cells, and enterochromaffin cells. I cells secrete cholecystokinin in response to the presence of fats in the small intestine. And cholecystokinin, as we all know, stimulates the contraction of gallbladder, thereby bile is released. And cholecystokinin also stimulates the pancreas to release its secretions. Similarly, S cells secrete secretin in response to the low pH of the chyme in the small intestine, and the secretin induces the secretion of bicarbonate salts from the pancreas and inhibits the secretion of gastric juices. Similarly, K cells secrete gastric inhibitory peptide in response to the acidic chyme that is entering into the small intestine. The gastric inhibitory peptide is a misnomer, as it actually stimulates the release of insulin. Finally, the enterochromaffin cells are mechanically stimulated by the presence of chyme in the small intestine, as they release the serotonin. Therefore, after all these epithelial cells found in the mucosal epithelium of the wall of the intestine, we have lamina propria. So each villus has a core of connective tissue in which neurovascular structures like lacteals of the small lymphatic vessels, arterioles or the small arteries, venules or the small veins which collect the blood, and also nerve fibers are formed. So therefore, lamina propria is basically connective tissue supporting the upper mucosal epithelium. So below the lamina propria. As usual, we have a very thin layer of muscularis mucosa. So it is composed of elastic fibers and smooth muscles, generally arranged in two layers, an outer layer of longitudinal smooth muscles and inner layer of circular smooth muscles. So these muscles, they may radiate from below deep into the lamina propria of each villus, so that they help in the contraction and relaxation of the villi. So with that, we finished with the structure of the first layer of wall of intestine, that is mucosa. So below the mucosa, we have submucosa. Submucosa consists of, again, loose layer of connective tissue with lot of fibers, but large blood vessels and also large lymphatic vessels called the lymphatics and nerves. So in the submucosa layer of the duodenum particularly, we have more number of mucus secreting glands called Brunner's glands. In between the submucosa and outer muscularis externa, we also have group of neurons forming plexus called Mucinous plexus. Therefore, below the submucosa, we also have muscularis externa. So muscularis externa is the third layer of wall of intestine. It again consists of smooth muscle layer, which contains a very thin layer of muscles, as unlike the stomach, it consists of only two layers of smooth muscles. These are the inner layer of circular muscles and the outer layer of longitudinal muscles, which occur in the form of bundles. In between these two layers of smooth muscles, we have again group of neurons forming plexus called Auerbach nerve plexus. Which are the parasympathetic plexus called myentic plexus also. So these layers of smooth muscles are used to create peristalsis. Peristalsis is the rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the wall of intestine to move the food down through the digestive system. Coming to the last layer of the wall of intestine called serosa or adventitia, is the outermost layer of loose connective tissue containing few blood vessels, lymphatics, nerves, which are covered by a visceral peritoneum, consists of a single layer of squamous epithelium called serosa, which provides protection to the intestine. So apart from these common structures we come across all along the small intestine, the three parts of the small intestine, that is duodenum, jejunum and ileum, also show some specific structures exclusively located in that area. The duodenum has more number of light staining branched tubulo acinar epithelial glands. That means they are multicellular glands called Brunner's glands in the submucosa layer. These Brunner's glands secrete lot of mucus. That's why they are also called mucus glands, as we have discussed, to neutralize the acidic chyme. Whereas in the ileum region, we have more number of lymphatic follicles forming a large number of groups of follicles called Peyer's patches, which are covered by phagocytic M cells, particularly in the submucosa and also in the lamina propria regions. But both Brunner's glands and Peyer's patches are absent in the jejunum region. At the end, coming to the functions of the small intestine, as we have discussed, the small intestine helps in the biochemical digestion of food, as many digestive enzymes are secreted by the small intestine, and also the secretions from the pancreas and liver, they reach the small intestine, so thereby it is the site of digestion of food. Similarly, the digested food is absorbed into the blood vessels through the wall of the small intestine. So therefore, the active absorption of the digested food also takes place in the small intestine. The plicae circularis, the villi and microvilli, they increase the surface area of absorption of these nutrients. Similarly, apart from these digestive and absorptive functions, small intestine also plays very important role in building the immune system. The Peyer's patches, which are located in the ileum of the small intestine, form a very important part of the digestive tract to increase the local immunity of the digestive system. As we all know, the lymph glands are the part of lymphatic system which provide a site for the antigens from the harmful bacteria to interact with the body's immune system, and therefore they will be presented to the immune system of the body. So therefore, the presence of gut flora appears to contribute positively to the host immune system. That's why I'm sure you are advised to have lot of lactobacillus in the form of curds. With these few important functions of the intestine, we have come to the end of the session. I'm sure in today's class, we have learned that intestine has an unique histological organization which helps the mammals in the digestion and absorption of varieties of food. So these are the some of the references which will help us in our future studies. Thank you. With that, we have come to the end of the today's session.